Thank you for joining us today in Thriving in Turbulence, Leading Immigrant Communities Against a Pandemic and Societal Upheaval. I am Erwin De Leon, a lecturer in Columbia University's Nonprofit Management Master's Program. Today's panel is part of the Leading Towards Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion series organized by Columbia University's Nonprofit Management, Negotiation and Conflict Resolution, and Human Capital Management Master's programs as part of the university's ongoing commitment to anti-racism work. I'd like to thank the program teams and the event teams especially for all their work in making this happen. Joining me today are Maria Wojcin, founder and executive director of the Young Center for Immigrant Children's Rights, based in Chicago, Illinois, and Faisal al-Juburi, associate vice president of fundraising for RAICES, or the Refugee and Immigrant Center for Education and Legal Services, headquartered in San Antonio, Texas. But I understand that Faisal is joining us from New York. And so we will talk about how their organizations and they themselves are leading during these turbulent times. For those joining us online, please type your questions in the Q&A function at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And we will try to get to as many of your questions as we can during the hour. Okay, so let's have at it. Maria and Faisal, yesterday we started a new chapter, as it were, but certain themes and challenges continue in our nation's story. We are amidst a pandemic that has exposed and exacerbated racial and economic inequalities. Individuals and communities are suffering great financial, psychological, and emotional distress, and we are painfully divided. So how are immigrants, the communities you serve, faring, and how have your organizations responded to what's going on?
Sure. So thank you, Erwin. I can start off. Thank you so much for having me. I mean, you know, obviously we're thrilled about the outcome of the election and excited to see the inauguration yesterday, but it doesn't mean that anything's changing overnight. I will say, I mean, the last 4 years, we could never ever have anticipated how difficult it would be for immigrants. And I think that will continue for quite some time because it's going to take a very long time to undo what's been done over the last 4 years. And I just want to also add that before the Trump administration, it was also very difficult and challenging. And we were certainly advocating with the government zealously. There was litigation against the government. So it's not as if all of that is going to go away with the Biden-Harris administration. So just a little background, the Young Center for Immigrant Children's Rights is based in Chicago, but we are a national organization with offices in 8 cities around the country. We serve a population that's really, you know, a small population. It is unaccompanied and separated immigrant children. So these are kids who come to the United States on their own. You all know by now, a few years ago, no one had even heard of these kids, but today everyone knows who they are. And I will say from the moment that the Trump administration came in, they targeted immigrants and immigrant children. So they issued their wish list of everything they wanted to get done during the administration. It was a 17-page document. Mm-hmm. Number one was a border wall. Number two was unaccompanied immigrant mm-hmm. children. That was their number two priority. And we have seen that for the last 4 years. And a lot has gotten very difficult in the immigration system for kids. Mm-hmm. And so our work as advocates, so our job is serving as a child advocate, advocating for the best interests of unaccompanied kids in immigration court, getting them released from custody, making arguments along the way. And that's become much more difficult at every step because of policy changes during the Trump administration. We also do policy work in Washington, D.C. We have a policy division. And obviously, we have been in defensive mode for 4 years. But the opportunity that we see now is that we have put together plans for reforming the immigration system. Mm-hmm. I mean, right now, kids are just, they're treated almost the same as adults, and they're just little minor fixes that everyone has been able to do. And our hope is to be able to really make progress under this new administration. So that's going to be very much a focus for us going forward.
So Maria, how have the children been affected with COVID, with the current pandemic? Mm-hmm.
Well, first of all, the government closed the border and they used COVID as an excuse to close the border. So there is a law that says that if a child comes to the border and they are unaccompanied, so separated from a parent or legal guardian, mm-hmm. they are taken into custody and they have the right to go before mm-hmm. a judge, to have an interview before an asylum officer. But under COVID, this government shut the border, and they claimed that the CDC had ordered them to do that. That turned out to be false. It was really an excuse to, mm-hmm. it's what they wanted to do all along, is close that border, and they were able to do it under COVID. So kids have gotten stuck. They've mm-hmm. gotten stuck in Mexico. There's something called the Remain in mm-hmm. Mexico program, which is have ended up being refugee camps, really, of the U.S.'s making. So kids have gotten stuck in these camps. They've sometimes had a very difficult time getting into the U.S., turned back. And then our government, it's just incredible to me, but our government has been flying these kids back to their mm-hmm. home countries without ever processing them here, without asking them, where are you going? Right. Will you be safe? Do you have a parent in home country? Mm-hmm. And that's what our government has been doing. But they've also done things like speed up immigration cases, giving the kids 2 weeks to come in and make their claim for legal relief. And as Faisal will, I'm sure, also talk about, these kids are not given legal representation at government expense. So it's very difficult. I mean, how can a kid make a case in immigration court without an attorney?
Absolutely. So Faisal, that's a great way to lead into you. So what about Raisis and your own work and what you're seeing underground?
No, thank you. And I kept nodding my head in agreement with Maria. And I want to first thank everyone for inviting us to speak and for participating today. This work is humbling, and it is, you see the worst in humanity, but on the flip side, you also see the very best, right? Because I come to you today, I am not a lawyer, I am not a community organizer, I am not a social services provider. I come as a nonprofit mm-hmm. professional. I am mm-hmm. the son of immigrants. I come from an Iraqi Muslim family, but I was raised here in the States, and I come as a concerned citizen. And my attention was brought to Raices and to really the humanitarian crisis that we are having along and within our own borders mm-hmm. here in the United States. Pretty much the same as most people who heard about ISIS. We've been around since 1986, but our visibility rose in 2018 at the height of the family separation mm-hmm. crisis under the zero tolerance policy. And but the work that we have been doing, far mm-hmm. preceded that and will continue, because this is not a partisan issue, right? Immigration is not a partisan problem. It is something that we have also seen in terms of the egregious sort of human rights abuses, something that has escalated now over several administrations. We saw it this goes back decades, but really in the past 2 decades, since September 11th, with the increased fear-mongering around mm-hmm. the other, with the creation of the Department of Homeland Security, which many average civilians do not realize, came after September 11th. So when everyone asks, right, well, how could we ever do away with an agency like that? It's like, well, most of our history is without that agency. An agency that has, had basically free reign, right? And so we are very much mm-hmm. committed to solving the long-term systemic mm-hmm. issues. It's not just about mm-hmm. a rapid response crisis. Why are we excited about mm-hmm. the dawn of a new administration? Mm-hmm. is because hopefully now mm-hmm. we can think in the way Maria was talking, how can we take a proactive strategic mm-hmm. approach to change mm-hmm. versus constantly being in this state of, well, when's the other shoe gonna drop? What's the other thing coming around mm-hmm. the corner? The purpose is to destabilize, mm-hmm. to, that was the intentions that we saw from the last administration. It was to denigrate, to dehumanize, mm-hmm. to destabilize, both in terms of the our service recipients, mm-hmm. but then also our service providers, mm-hmm. Constantly trying to figure out what new change, right. and what new sort of maze do we have to go through. And COVID-19 definitely mm-hmm. Exacerbated those issues, but that was to be expected, because in times of crisis, who is gonna suffer the most? Those that are already the most vulnerable, right? Mm-hmm. And so we definitely saw the impact on our communities. We've seen it with family detention and the threat of family separation that arose again, using COVID as an excuse. Mm-hmm. So in May, we were able to, our family detention services team, our lawyers and social mm-hmm. services providers were able to recognize that there was a coordinated effort across the three mm-hmm. family detention centers. Mm-hmm. In the United States, two in Texas, and one in Pennsylvania, to have parents sign away the rights to their children mm-hmm. Without access to their legal representation. Right? Mm-hmm. So we saw that. Mm-hmm. We saw then not to get too granular, but mm-hmm. with the Flores Agreement, we saw an opportunity for children to be released, and there was nothing that said the parents had to remain in detention. Mm-hmm. But that was the sticking mm-hmm. point. And yeah. I know that our legal services providers are adamant that we do not separate parents and mm-hmm. children again, right? So DHS was adamant that the only mm-hmm. option was stay together in detention, mm-hmm. risk getting infected as the COVID-19 crisis, mm-hmm. Pandemic ripped through mm-hmm. these already squalid facilities. We've seen it in our refugee mm-hmm. and our other undocumented mm-hmm. Service recipients, where we have exponentially escalated food and housing insecurity because mm-hmm. of the crisis. The last year has been insult to injury. And then mm-hmm. add on top of that, the fight against DACA, right? Everyone mm-hmm. saw that, started under the Obama administration, right? And then from the very beginning, the Trump administration tried to dismantle it. And what is so egregious about the DACA in the year of COVID is that mm-hmm. so there are about 700,000 active DACA right. recipients, right? That many know as the Dreamers, mm-hmm. Those who were brought here under when they were children, and who DACA is not a status, mm-hmm. but DACA mm-hmm. is it gets you a stay of deportation, mm-hmm. The ability to work, a driver's right. license, basics. So about 700,000 active DACA recipients in 2020, over 200,000 of them classified as essential workers during mm-hmm. The pandemic. approximately, it was about 29,000 within healthcare on the front lines of the fight. Mm-hmm. And continued mm-hmm. efforts to mm-hmm. strip DACA away from them. Supreme mm-hmm. Court saves right. it on a technicality, but still mm-hmm. a continued back and forth. Mm-hmm. And I say all of this to say that it's this, what we have seen within raíces mm-hmm. is that immigrants are not a monolith. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. that there is a diverse patchwork to mm-hmm. the communities that we are talking about here, that immigration is an intersectional issue here. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So with the mm-hmm. rightful elevation of the Black Lives Matter movement this summer, right? And the call mm-hmm. for racial mm-hmm. equity and justice, you know, we see that within immigration as well. It is you can be an immigrant and you can mm-hmm. be Black and you can be right. LGBTQ and you have to suffer compounded insults. Yes. But you know, our Haitian clients mm-hmm. who are in detention between June 2019 and June 2020. Mm-hmm. We paid on average, their bond payment was on average 54% higher than any other of our clients.
Those are pretty staggering statistics. So you mentioned a good point that, you know, this demands a long-term vision. This demands a long-term, a lot of work that will take some time. So Maria, what actions can one take? I know that I believe it was today or that the Biden administration just put forth their own bill proposal to Congress, which we know how Congress works. So beyond that, what can nonprofits such as the Young Center or Raíces or other nonprofits, not even necessarily doing immigrant work, what can be done to address both the current situation, right? So we've got all these immigrants, undocumented and low-income immigrants who are suffering under COVID and the economic downturn. What can organizations do?
Well, I think everyone is mobilizing and has been mm-hmm. ever since, you know, we found out that Biden won the election to make plans and, mm-hmm. and get together and work together to change policies and undo what's been done. I think one of the things that's really positive is that we, and I'm sure Faisal will know people, or your Raíces people mm-hmm. will know people, the Young Center knows people who are actually going to be in this administration, who were on the transition mm-hmm. team, who are going to be appointed to positions in Homeland Security, Department mm-hmm. of Justice, Health and Human Services, where we can actually make change. And these are people we have relationships with. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there is a real opportunity now for us to make those changes. Mm-hmm. And these are people who we worked with under mm-hmm. the Obama administration and worked with them to develop, for example, we developed a framework for considering best interests, even if we can't yet change the law. Mm-hmm. So we see that we will be able to make progress with that framework under, because these people are in the administration, because they actually worked on a mm-hmm. lot of the framework and we didn't have that before. So, I mean, for me, it's working across organizations, mm-hmm. You know, not only immigrant rights organizations, but other organizations. And we've worked hard to make those connections, especially since the Black Lives Matter and the George Floyd murder, to reach across. I mean, we certainly have, as Faisal mentioned, we've also had many clients who are from countries in Africa. I mean, Ethiopia, mm-hmm. Somalia, Ghana, people come from all over the world to the United States. So we've always had those clients, but we've made a point of, in our social media in particular, mm-hmm. Uplifting, reposting from Movement for Black Lives, Color mm-hmm. of Change, National Black Lives mm-hmm. Matter. And then, just increased our commentary on you know, on some of those issues. And then we've also recently done webinars on, you know, focused on the children, African and Black children who have been immigrants, who've been, you know, tremendously impacted by everything that has happened.
So Faisal, same question for you, but maybe if I can, I guess it's a leading question. You mentioned earlier that, you know, how just the demonization, my word, paraphrasing how you've, how basically, I guess, some sectors have painted the immigrant community, right, in whatever way. Now, the current administration is really trying to change the tone, right, just the tone of, about how we talk to each other and how we deal with each other as individuals and communities. So do you think that will make a difference? And number two, what else can we do to change things long term?
It's a great question. I'm a words guy, right? And so I have a communications degree as well. I studied my bachelor's is in history, and I've had a lifetime of studying dramatic mm-hmm. literature. And I think, you know, the last several years have been a social mm-hmm. experiment that has proven words matter. So yes, I think that it will make a difference. Mm-hmm. I think that when we have leadership that respects human life, that it will have an effect, you know, not just on immigration, but mm-hmm. in any area where you're talking about marginalized mm-hmm. communities. So. Do I think it'll make a difference? Yes, totally. I also think that, you know, specifically within immigration, what needs to happen is it is about the narrative change, right? And how are we telling the stories that need to be told? How are we helping to empower well-meaning civilians with the tools that they need in order to speak mm-hmm. effectively, respectfully in a society mm-hmm. that has in some ways prided itself as an immigrant mm-hmm. nation, right? Mm-hmm. But then on in other ways completely mm-hmm. to mm-hmm. borrow your word, demonized the other, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So and I think that's actually what's so profound about our the mm-hmm. approach that our policy advocates and community organizers took to creating something called the mm-hmm. Migrant Justice Platform that is about policy recommendations, mm-hmm. But also side by side with practical application mm-hmm. of how do we change the narrative. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I think that that is going to be super important. I also think that really, you know, bottom line right now is, you know, hopefully the Biden administration, the Biden-Harris administration, leads with the example of accountability. And what we saw, what we have seen is, you know, what happens to our nation, what happens to our national values when we aren't looking, mm-hmm. when we aren't holding our elected officials accountable, mm-hmm. when we are letting these grave injustices happen mm-hmm. in our name. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was gonna ask another question, but you brought a good point about holding individuals or certain sectors accountable. How can immigrant communities, particularly those that are not even recognized or don't have legal status, mm-hmm. how can those communities and their allies hold others accountable? Maria, maybe if you'd like to jump in.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's going to be about organizing and, you know, being organized and making sure that the public is aware of what's mm-hmm. going on. I think one of our concerns is that now that it's a new administration, that the focus will shift away from immigration. I mean, like Faisal, the Young Center grew exponentially during family separation because there was just so much attention to what was happening. And yet, you know, just like Raisis, the Young Center has been around mm-hmm. for a very long time and working on these issues when it was a much smaller number of kids. And so I think it's going to be really important to keep the public focused on that, keep funders focused on that. And I think also getting funders, I mean, I think organizations, of course, like Raisis and the Young Center need to continue to maintain our funding, but it's going to be very important to get funding to the smaller community-based organizations that are doing the actual community organizing, because, you know, we need that in order to take the issue to an organization that can actually file litigation mm-hmm. or, you know, has people to go and do policy work. Although, I mean, community-based organizations can organize and go to Washington and mm-hmm. knock on doors and demand to speak to their legislators. I do believe that, that makes a huge difference. But we have to take the focus on and somehow make mm-hmm. sure that people don't think, well, we're fine now. Everything's going to be fine. Mm-hmm. We've got, you know, wonderful new president and vice president, and we don't have to worry about immigration or mm-hmm. immigrants or communities of mm-hmm. immigrants anymore. It's all going to be fine. And I obviously that's not going to be the case. And you know, we don't want to go back to normal. There's not a normal that we want to return to. Things were bad before. They got exponentially worse. But we don't want to go back to the before time either.
Yeah, there's a really great Arabic saying that I love to use in the circumstances of like. Those who have seen death are cool with a fever, right? But for me, it's like about right now. It's the you know, how do we demand health, right? Addressing immigration in America is about the health of our society. I worry about complacency. Mm-hmm. I worry about being lulled into a false sense of comfort. I think that in a lot of ways, regardless of the record, and to be clear, under the Obama administration, there were some egregious injustices mm-hmm. to the immigrant community. To do a shout out for Raisa's, we do have a podcast called Homeland and Security, which is an 8-part documentary podcast that sort of takes us from how we went to, you know, 9/11 to then how all immigrants are the enemy, and how, you know, in the wake of the protests last summer, of how really any voice of dissent became the enemy. But that, you know, that being said, I worry about that from a funding perspective. Mm-hmm. I worry about that from mm-hmm. a community organizing perspective. After the trauma, really. Mm-hmm. Of the last few years in particular, that problem solved mentality will creep in and affect immigration and affect a whole host of social justice issues.
Okay, a number of questions are coming in, excellent questions. But before I go to our audience questions, Faisal, I will be remiss if I don't ask something that Maria brought up. And you actually, that's why I smiled, mentioned fundraising, right? So for those of us in the sector, the reality is, while it's called the nonprofit sector, the reality is we do need the funds, we need to do the fundraising. So seeing that you're the associate vice, you know, that's your work, right, in fundraising. So what are you seeing? What are the challenges and opportunities for nonprofits doing this work, serving immigrants or working with immigrants? And Maria, perhaps you could also chime in, but how are we in terms of raising money.
I will say, Maria has alluded to this, we definitely saw an outpouring of public support, especially, you know, around mm-hmm. Family separation, and that became a game changer. And I think that we as an organization took that responsibility seriously. You know, it's that we were, you know, one of a handful of organizations that were entrusted by the public, really, you know, to be able to fight on the you know, on the front lines, and advocate for the needs of our constituents. And what I really appreciate, and what drew me to Raices, as a nonprofit professional, was how thoughtfully those resources were applied, both in terms of you know, in terms of direct services, the approach to holistic services that we were able to establish, mm-hmm. so that we are looking at the full 360, mm-hmm. right? So it's that, how are we offering the legal services, social services, mm-hmm. as well as the community organizing and advocacy needs? And then how are we taking what we are learning from that direct contact, mm-hmm. on the front lines, and applying that within our within policy work, mm-hmm. And also within our litigation department? Mm-hmm. So I, you know, from a fundraising perspective, we have, I think that right now it's about the shift, mm-hmm. and the pivot of what are we fighting against, mm-hmm. versus what are we fighting for. And I think generosity, the generosity that we have seen is great, mm-hmm. But I think it's about right now, mm-hmm. ensuring that people know that it's not just about solving an emergent crisis, mm-hmm. That it's, you know, it is about the you know, the what is at stake is really, what does it mean to be an American, right? What does it mean to be an American to you? What do you want to stand for? The values. How do you, you know, how do we want to, you know, how do we want to be leading in this world? And how does immigration play such a profoundly important role in that? And I think that, you know, I think that people recognize it, both in terms of the, you know, the $5, $10, and $15 donors, and you know, bundle to become millions, as well as, you know, those institutional, those corporations, those foundations, you know, those individuals who really want to make transformative gifts because they understand this to be a, you know, a cause of our generation. But bottom line, that narrative shift that we were talking about, that is important within the fundraising space as well, because so much of this is about educating. So much of this is, and I will take coming from an immigrant family myself, I still was so blithely ignorant, mm-hmm. To the scope of the human rights crisis that is immigration in America. So I think it's it is about that educating, that engaging, that dialogue, so that people understand it's not just fighting against the foul, dehumanizing, mm-hmm. demonizing language that came mm-hmm. out over the last several years.
It's about making a case, right, for the bigger picture. Maria, do you agree that is how we can make our argument for support for our work, or I'd say your work on the ground?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I want to back up just a minute and just talk about some of the really practicalities that we've dealt with as a nonprofit in this time of, you know, as the title of the webinar is Turbulence. So, I mean, last May, which was several months into COVID, we embarked on a scenario planning, and we looked at three scenarios, you know, best case scenario, COVID goes away in June, the economy bounces back by the fall and everything is okay. Well, of course, we knew we would never be in that. And then, you know, the middle case scenario being that the pandemic would continue, the border would still be closed, and everyone is impacted. But Biden would win, and that would mean that, you know, there would be an opportunity for all of us to come back and do our work. And then the worst case, of course, was that Trump would win and the border would remain closed. And then we would need a pivot plan. I mean, the Young Center, we've always been afraid of the government. We do receive some government funding, and we've always been afraid the government is going to cut us off. And it was hanging over our head for 4 years. So how would we pivot if that were to happen? So, I mean, we did a lot of planning in terms of fundraising, and, you know, we saw the family separation bump. And then, you know, that quieted down. But we, you know, we weren't worried, but we started to be worried with COVID because people are concerned about the economy. What's going to happen to the economy? Are people going to be able to give donations given what's happening during a pandemic? So, I mean, we had the scenario planned, and I think we have to do that again because we have to think about the possibilities now that there is a Democratic administration. How is that going to shift the way our donors are thinking? And then with that, what are we going to do about it? What, you know, how are we going to talk to our donors? And clearly we're sending the message, as I'm sure everyone is, that we have to undo everything that's been done. And, and you can't just wave a wand and do that. There's going to be a lot of work that's going to have to happen to undo while at the same time as building a better system. So I think it's getting that message out to people and having conversations with people. I mean, we did, you know, we certainly had funders say, well, what are you going to do if Trump wins again? What are you going to do if Biden wins again? I mean, I think they're two different scenarios, but we have to scenario plan even under this, what I would call best scenario now with the new administration.
So I will, I think, jump in with one audience question, which in a way gets into the weeds, but is totally related to what we are talking about. And so someone asks, I am the director of a community nonprofit supporting Latino immigrants in Southern Indiana. Do you see a pathway to federal funding for agencies like ours, working to support families, working to improve their economic, education, and immigrant status?
Good question.
Is this part of you know, the what you've both been talking about
I mean, it's really important because it's, you know, that's a community-based organization. And I think the struggle for community-based organizations is having the resources, having, you know, having a development team, having, I'm sure, you know, Faisal, you have people who are watching, you know, watching the funding opportunities from the federal government go by and monitoring that. It's very difficult to do that without the staff. So, I mean, I think that's the, but I think even if you're a small organization, you can learn how to look for opportunities that are issued all the time that you might apply for. And then I think the other thing is getting involved with legislators, because the legislators are the ones who champion funding for their communities. So I would say start with your you know, federal representative, your congressperson, talk to your senators and start there. I mean, they'll listen to you. They really will, because, you know, you are their constituent. Tell them what you need and work with them to see what can happen in terms of creating a fund and or making it possible for your, you know, your nonprofit to be able to access support from the federal government now.
And I think, I think what you're touching on really, Maria, is like, what is the, you know, the core principle of fundraising? It's about relationships, right? So I think it is even with institutional funding, when you're looking at a government, a major foundation, a corporation, that at the end of the day, it is people to people, right? And so remembering that, centering that, and also recognizing that it is also about persistence, these are about long lead opportunities. These are about, they are not going to be instant gratification, but they are about they can pay off. And so I would just, I would advocate to remember that.
Okay. So let me, I have a couple of questions here about how to help immigrant communities. So let's start with one. How do we support immigrant communities in the midst of a pandemic, particularly in the area of educational attainment, so they are not further disenfranchised by an educational system that was not built to have them succeed? So we see that being here in New York City, which has a huge immigrant community and the challenges faced by the public school system, I see that, right? And everyone's concerned about how we've got some people even have called the lost generation, and not just with immigrant children, just children in general who had to deal with our shift in the way we teach them and to take care of them. So any thoughts on how that can be addressed with immigrant communities that are further disadvantaged?
I mean, I think it comes back to community organizing and you know, in that instance, agitating with your city, your community, your local board of education to make sure that, you know, you get resources to your families and your communities. I mean, I don't know how people are managing right now. I don't know how, you know, families that don't have Wi-Fi. I mean, some mm-hmm. cities have made sure that, you know, they've arranged for kids and families to be able to access Wi-Fi and get on the web. But I mean, in many places, it's just not possible. But I think the only way to do it is to get together and ask for it or demand it. From your city and your whoever is, you know, handling the education in that community. But I think it's I don't have an answer, Erwin. I think it's a really, I wish I did. I think it's really difficult, and I think it's going to be so difficult for communities of color, immigrant communities, especially immigrant communities are afraid to come forward and ask for anything because they can get in trouble because of the public charge rule that would eliminate the possibility that they could have status in the U.S. And of course, there are legal challenges to that, and there have been some very good decisions. But again, that's something that this new administration is going to have to undo. But part of the worst thing that rule did was scare people into not asking and not, you know, not getting anything. And so, I mean, my fear is that people will be afraid to get the vaccine. They will be afraid to ask for anything for their parents, for their children, because it could mean that they lose out in their in terms of immigration status, or that they get caught, they get apprehended and deport. I mean, I think a lot of what happened over the last 4 years was drumming up fear. And, you know, I think that that's going to persist for a long time.
I would agree. I think that, you know, that is, you know, the fear that, the fear for accessing any type of help and services, that I would say that that even, you know, that existed beforehand and has been exacerbated in the last several years, and then the needs have only increased under COVID. So I you know, one of the ways that we at IESIS have tried to have tried to counteract that is establishing a hotline that provides an element of anonymity so that people can feel comfortable trying to learn about what resources we can recommend based upon a thorough vetting process. But again, you know, what Maria is pointing to is that we're going to be dealing with the vestiges of trauma. And I do not say mm-hmm. that as, I do not say that right. gratuitously. It is the, right. The trauma mm-hmm. of the fear mongering. It is the right. trauma of the actual actions and inactions mm-hmm. designed to hurt, and the trauma of a society that is going through COVID, you know, a pandemic, a mm-hmm. once in a century pandemic. And I think that, once again, the most vulnerable will, are sadly suffering the most, mm-hmm. but we have not even begun to wrap our heads as a society around the lingering impact of this of mm-hmm. this health crisis for the United States and the world, but like, you know, mm-hmm. like how this is going to manifest from mm-hmm. a mental and a behavioral health as well as sort of from an access and education standpoint. And, I would say mm-hmm. in terms of how do you help from a practical mm-hmm. application standpoint, I would say, I believe in community, you know, organizing and volunteerism. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, the practical of the moment is, or if you are of means and can make, you know, an investment and support, it is about, how can you volunteer to, mm-hmm. To help with digital literacy, mm-hmm. within these, for these students and these families, can you volunteer or donate, mm-hmm. Some of the technical needs, both the hotspots, mm-hmm. If they are not equipped with Wi-Fi, or the tablets and the computers, a lot of times too, we have run into issues of, I have seen mm-hmm. firsthand, not with Raices, but actually in the New York City school system of a shame surrounding asking for resources that are readily available, but a shame that exists. And so you have a whole family trying to make do with one laptop, mm-hmm. right? And mm-hmm. you've got, you know, parents who are trying to work and multiple children trying to go to school. I would also, whatever you can do to also ensure that, from a volunteerism standpoint, I talk about, I look at how can you support students in mentorship, how can you support students in digital literacy, and how can you volunteer and support I am drawing a blank. My name is, but in terms of how do you address the issue of food security? How do you work with food banks? How do you make sure that, you know, so many of the kids who their meals depended upon mm-hmm. going into the physical school, how can you make sure that they mm-hmm. Still continue to have access to nourishment?
Yeah, thank you, Faisal, because you actually answered a number of questions that have come in, and really they're around. Really, if I were to simplify, and I hope the audience forgives me for this, but really at deep down, I think a lot of people would like to help. Like, and the question is, mm-hmm. how can I help? The simplest mm-hmm. way of saying it, and you've answered a few, but I think there's one that, and I don't know if we have an answer to this, right? So what are those quick start guides where we can look, learn, and adapt for helping this normalization, meaning normalization of bringing immigrants out from the shadows, treating them like we would anyone else, regardless of where they're from or what. So you mentioned a few things, but is there one way, or is it, what I'm hearing is that immigrant needs are no different from some of the needs, and that we just get back. What do you think, Maria?
I mean, government is just so important to everything. And I mean, mm-hmm. I live in Chicago, and and our mayor makes a point of saying, you know, we will not, you will not be in jeopardy mm-hmm. if you're undocumented, if you come to this clinic and get a vaccine. You can ask for things, and you'll be mm-hmm. protected in the city of Chicago. I mean, in terms of that, right. Certainly ICE can come in and do what they want to do, but I think it's trying to counter the fear mm-hmm. that people have about coming forward and asking for what they mm-hmm. need, but also having, you know, the city itself go out and offer it. Mm-hmm. And again, you know, then, you know, that gets back into the community and making sure that people in the community know how they can access, for example, mm-hmm. you know, 5G or get a laptop for their children, or how they can get a vaccine. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, getting the information into that community is really important. And then, you know, getting, you know, making sure that that travels through mm-hmm. the community. So it's public service announcements. But it's really difficult to counter that fear. And mm-hmm. so, yeah, I don't have any brilliant answers, I'm afraid, Erwin. Sorry.
No. It's a hard question. And I don't think that there's one way, right?
Right.
You wanted to say something.
I think we're looking, the reason why this is a hard question to answer, why these are all hard questions to answer, is that we are looking at, they all lead back to a major culture shift, right?
Yeah.
That needs to happen. It may sound sort of trite to say, but that doesn't happen until we all feel accountable to take that first step, right? And in whichever way makes sense to us in our own communities. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I would say, you know, it is about educating ourselves for sure. Mm-hmm. I think that there are opportunities at Raices and elsewhere mm-hmm. To volunteer, to organize, mm-hmm. To both sign and amplify petitions, to have turnkey ways to reach out to your mm-hmm. elected officials to sort of demand the change mm-hmm. that you want to see, that you want to be a part of. Mm-hmm. I would encourage that, shout out, go to migrantjusticeplatform.org. And you can sign up to be a migrant justice warrior, and you can also take a look at some of our recommendations for the policy changes we'd like to see. All that said, though, it's that again, it's it is also as simple as making sure that you are the voice for mm-hmm. the type of progress you want to see in your communities, that mm-hmm. you are raising that up at the dinner table, you are bringing that up, you know, amongst mm-hmm. your friends. That, you know, I think, you know, one of the most fascinating things, like from like social media, can be the echo chamber, but it can also sort of reveal so many fascinating sort of truths about our current lived experience. Mm-hmm. One of the simplest, you know, some of the simplest statements, especially over the last, you know, several weeks of, if you were wondering what you would have done at any major pivotal milestone moment in world history, mm-hmm. right, where human rights mm-hmm. Were being threatened, if you ever wondered what you would have done, well, mm-hmm. look at what you're doing right now, right? because that's what you would have done, mm-hmm. right? Like, mm-hmm. and so it's about one of the biggest threats, I think, to the health of our society is if we do not have the difficult conversations with our loved ones, with our allies, with our foes, with everyone in between, because we don't want to go there. We want to be. Mm-hmm. We don't want to get political. We don't want to whatever right now. Like it is. It is about not being afraid to speak the truth, right? And I think, you know, Maria really speaks beautifully about how, and so much more eloquently than I could, but about the importance of the collaboration between organizations. In the same way, that is an element of organizing.
Right.
I hate when and I think it's valid in this context, as a nonprofit professional, I always hate when I see nonprofits like working in silos, and when ego sort of dictates, and that instead of focusing on efficiencies and how you can make maximum impact for those you're serving, right? So like it is about that collaboration. And I say, mm-hmm. the direct service work that, you know, like what we're doing, like, you know, what our teams are doing is also, you know, just as important as I think, you know, Jose Antonio Vargas and his, you know, Define American. And being able to influence, like, in popular culture, how we depict immigrants. How, when you're going on Netflix and getting ready to binge watch, like, how what you're being fed, how that respectfully honors the humanity of the, you know, of the population that you're reflecting.
Well, let me ask you this, and I suddenly realized we're running out of time here, but I think one of my last questions, which might be the second to the last, would be, you know, I, one thing with my own work, my own research with, you know, and being an immigrant myself, I've seen how the immigrant communities, the leadership, the organizations do work together, right? And do our best to support each other. But a question I have is like, but how do you, we, how do we work with those who are not our natural allies? You know, one of the programs that's supporting this whole series is has to do with negotiation and conflict resolution. Like, so what are, I think more like organizationally, right? Like what can be done? Because I agree with you, Faisal, a lot of it starts with us. And that is true with the conversations at the dinner table, right? And Maria, you mentioned about actually reaching, building relationships with legislators or what have you. If I can put it back now to the level of organizations, what can they do?
So are you talking, Erwin, about, you know, immigrant rights organizations bridging over to what kinds of organ? I mean, I'm trying to think of something that would not be a natural, a nonprofit that was so,
Well, okay, let me rephrase. So for instance, let's do a for instance. What if you were in a city or, well, or a state that's not as welcoming, right, as Chicago or New York or even San Antonio, in spite of it being in Texas, right? So what if it were in some other state or city where the whatever, you know, it's just not as welcoming as where we are at. So what could organizations, let's say, if there were an immigrant serving organization there, what can it do?
I mean, I think what I would do is I would reach out to local organizations that have been in existence forever. I don't know. Knights of Columbus are one of the groups that, and go and make a presentation to people and talk to them about your work, about your organization, introduce yourselves to them. And I mean, some organizations, no, I wouldn't try because it's not going to work. But I do think that when people know, when they get to know you, it changes everything. And I think going back to also something that Faisal mentioned, volunteering. I mean, for me, when you, it's all about the other. And when you don't know the other, they're going to stay the other. But when you do get to know someone, everything changes. And so volunteering, and doing something with a community that you wouldn't normally volunteer with, you're going to get to know people, and then you're going to bring that back to your own community. And I really think that's, it's one way that we can promote some change.
Great. Faisal?
Yeah, I mean, I think you're hitting on a point that's very, like, again, it transcends just immigration, how the art of dialogue, right? The ability to engage with and across difference, to do it respectfully, to do it while still recognizing and reinforcing each other's humanity. And how do we, you know, I think, you know, on a grand scale, is how do we ensure that we're not thinking and we're not talking and we're not approaching things in binaries, because I think we have like culturally a tendency to go into us versus them. And you know, and again, like for some, that is the, that is a tactic that is used strategically in order to gain power. But the change again is that it is through dialogue. And I really think, again, what, you know, Maria, like you talking about, you know, it is about the humanizing force of that interpersonal mm-hmm. relationship mm-hmm. building and why, mm-hmm. you know, volunteerism can be so powerful. I think, you know, that again, like can really do a nice sort of full circle here is mm-hmm. why did it take, you know, immigration in America is rooted in family separation mm-hmm. in myriad forms. Mm-hmm. You know, that goes back, you know, to the start. Right. But why did family separation in the way that it manifested mm-hmm. in 2018 draw such huge attention? Mm-hmm. And it's because that visceral reaction we have mm-hmm. is just humans mm-hmm. seeing a child ripped from his mother. Mm-hmm. And I think it's like when you can anchor and like, again, we respect our differences and that's what makes us strong, but there are these core human principles yes. that remind mm-hmm. you, oh, we're the mm-hmm. same.
and I think that's a great way. Unfortunately, we've come to the end, but I think the way we started, as I said, we're starting a new chapter here. And I think it sounds like we all have a part to play, right? Yeah. In retelling, or at least remembering and retelling the story of what it really means to be Americans, because we all came here at some point. Yes. And so thank you, Faisal. Thank you, Maria.
Thank you, Erwin. Thank you all for having us. It was very fun to talk to you, Faisal. It was really a pleasure.
And we will continue.
But thank you for bringing us together, Erwin.
Oh, this is a wonderful conversation, which we plan on having again. Mm-hmm. And as a matter of fact, I invite all those in the audience to our next event. Coming up, so you can keep an eye out for that. And so have a good evening, everyone.
You too. Yes.
And be well.
You too. Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.